And the analysis of Shields and Brooks, that is syndicated columnist Mark Shields and New York Times columnist David Brooks. It's good to see you both.
Thank you.
So, Mark, looking at this CPAC conference that Kwame was reporting on, what are we to make of the Republican Party, the conservative movement?
Well, first, a cautionary note. The CPAC is not representative of the Republican Party by any means. I mean, the straw poll in the past of presidential candidates has elected President Rudy Giuliani, President Jack Kemp 3 times, President Steve Forbes, President Ron Paul.
So, I mean,
they're just outside of the mainstream. But I think Whit Ayers, the Republican pollster, put his finger on it when he said, you know, the Republicans have lost 5 of the last 6 presidential elections popular vote, and that obviously includes the 2000. And Judy, the most revealing thing to me was the response that Rand Paul got. He was the rock star, I thought, of this gathering, and in part it's because I think the discredited over the last 12 years, Republican foreign policy game plan, which is let's go in first and ask questions later, has been really undermined and sabotaged by both the American experience in Iraq and the American experience in Afghanistan. And there's been a long tradition of isolationism in the Republican Party, but I think that there's now a reluctance, a certain caution that hadn't been there in the past about foreign intervention.
So Rand Paul has struck a chord?
I'm curious about that. You know, he has at the moment. Mm-hmm. But this is a party that believes in American leadership in the world, that believes America has an important role to play as the world leader in creating a global order, free trade, free waterways, free commerce, free movement of people. That happens because of U.S. military might. The idea of the party is not going to be that party. It's happened. In the 1920s, the party shifted and became a much more isolationist party. The idea that this party is going to go back to that, I'll have to see it to believe it. Now, right now, they're in a mood where the president from the other party, a mood of non-intervention, a mood of austerity, a mood of war exhaustion. But when there's a threat from Iran, I still believe the Republican Party is going to be a defense party. It's going to be a pretty interventionist party globally. But Rand Paul is the key unknown here. And he is leading the party one way. Marco Rubio is leading another. As we sit here in about an hour and a half, Jeb Bush is going to give a speech, which is probably the most reformist of all the speeches that's going to be delivered.
Reformist.
Meaning we need to, what Whit Ayers said. So Marco Rand Paul, he's reformist in one way. Let's pull back. Let's be more libertarian. Marco Rubio said something to me phenomenally stupid. We don't need new ideas. Mm-hmm. That's never a good thing to say. But nonetheless, he's a more mainstream and moderate. I think Jeb Bush is pushing in the other direction. We've really got to change our message. We've got to talk to people who are poor, to working class. So there, you're beginning to see the splits, even though the CPAC is not represented.
Jeb Bush, it'd be interesting. I agree Jeb Bush has great credentials. He hasn't run an election since 2002. And his rustiness was on display here last week when he had to change his position 3 times in the space of 24 hours on immigration.
He wrote a book about it,
and he had to move away from his own book before the book was basically autographed. I mean, you know, so I agree with you. He had credentials going in, but it's been a long time. This is a tough sport. Politics is a contact sport. Jack Jamon was fond of saying it ain't beanbag, and I think he may be in a question of accepting an elbow or two.
But you agree with Mark's initial comment here that this is not representative of most Republicans. They had most prominent Republicans speaking.
People show up to this event. It's become an event where people show up
mm-hmm.
every year.
10,000.
But you can never measure anything by what they're applauding, because this is a group that is at one wing of the party, a more hardcore, probably more libertarian. Traditionally, a mixture of older and also college kids who have been comped, and so this is not where
you
the Republican
they
Party
free,
is.
So that,
right, and so yeah. You know, Michelle Bachmann fine with this group, Sarah Palin fine. Those people were not nominated, and so this is don't measure the audience, but pay attention to the speeches.
I just add this: that any group that doesn't invite Chris Christie, the most popular politician in the country, let alone Republican politician, Bob McDonnell, a governor of Virginia who showed great bipartisan skill in getting a transportation bill through, a major plan that required raising taxes, and instead invites Donald Trump. You know, I think you have to question its seriousness and where it is on the political compass.
Let's talk about the president. He continued, David, this week, this charm offensive outreach to Congress. Why is he doing this, and does it look like it's working?
So why he's doing it, the cynical explanation, which I would never stoop to, is that he's a little down in the polls. The positive implications are he's got a new chief of staff, Dennis McDonough, who's more of an outreach kind of guy. And also maybe he thinks he can get something done. And so is it working? I say yes, it is. Now, has the lion laid down with the lamb? No. But
wait a minute, which one is the lion and which one is the lion?
I'll let Mark answer that question. Mark, that's Mark.
I am the taxidermist.
We've got two jackals, actually, if I'm going to be honest. But so here's what's happened. And a bunch of people I've spoken to over the last week, they've decided we're going to have fights, but we're not going to take them to the nuclear level. And we're just going to try to, it's a switch metaphors, hit some signals. We're not going to do big tax reform. We're not going to do a grand bargain. But we're going to try to get some small budget deals going, and we're going to make the government a little less dysfunctional so it's less impinging on the economy, because you keep hearing more and more these days the economy is ready to take off. And if we can just get government slightly out of the way for a couple of years, we can get some really nice growth, and that'll change things up. And I think they are succeeding in denuclearizing our conflicts. No last-minute budget deals, no fiscal cliffs, no debt defaults. Let the economy grow for a change.
What are you hearing?
getting government out of the way. I love that. I mean, that's a great one. I mean, after what we've been through in this country with absolutely no control, and we just learned again this week that banks too big to fail are either too big to be reprimanded, controlled by the federal government. But I'd say this, Judy. There's an old line in politics, you dance with the girl who brung you. Barack Obama didn't do that. Barack Obama, over the past 7 years, has gone into hundreds, if not thousands, of rooms. People with large egos, people of great accomplishment, people who are quite skeptical toward him, and he went in and he charmed them. Charmed them to the point not only they supported him, they wrote checks for him. He comes to Washington and that stopped. He never spent any time, effort, or charm on members of Congress. And now, in the twilight of his presidency, he says, well, maybe what worked in Duluth and Des Moines and Detroit and Dallas and all over the country, Beverly Hills, maybe I could even try it on Capitol Hill. And I think that, first of all, the dinner went well with the senators. I would say this, you got to bring him into the White House. I mean, it's great to go up to the Hill and at the Jefferson Hotel. Fine. But I mean, you got the White House. Nobody talks about going to the White House, you know, without a sense of awe. I went to the White House. I met with the president. I don't mean to drop names.
Well, would they go if he invited them?
Are you kidding me? Of course they'd go. And I just think once, if you can get conversations going between Republicans and Democrats, I mean, I think he's right in saying some people have trouble supporting anything that I'm for, that they can't be for it. But I just think, listen, the other stuff wasn't working. The out going in and campaigning on an issue in certain areas and being on TV and kicking the daylights out of it, that wasn't working, and it was hurting his numbers.
But you're saying they need to be, he needs to get the parties together, because so far he's been going to meet with Democrats separately from
meeting. Well, but I think he can be the catalyst for doing that. But I think it's, you know, and it can't be something like they said to Ron Fournier of the National Journal, wow, this is just a joke, we're doing this for pretense. I mean, it's got to be sustained. It can't be a one-hit wonder.
Well, Mark says this is the twilight of his presidency.
So. Well, it sort of doesn't feel like the first year in administration, like the first few months. It feels kind of exhaustion. You know, those of us who go, we're interviewing in the White House, interviews in Congress, they have differences, not as big as they think. They have a lot of mythology about the other sides. And so just having these meetings would be a good thing, personal relationships. And so I think we've begun to see a little change in mode, as I say. Secondly, they've created space for some deals. So the people right now, there are 8 senators sitting in Capitol Hill doing immigration. Mm-hmm. They're making incredible progress, really good progress. And I think that's part of the tune. And if I could just defend this idea of getting government out of the way. Listen, we've got 24% of the economy is the government. We're not shrinking into Hong Kong Wonderland here. But it's, without question, just in a cyclical sense, uncertainty about Washington, these fiscal catastrophes, these debt ceiling, middle-of-the-night things, that's had an unnerving effect on investment. And if we can just stop that, that would help the economy.
Aren't you the same guy who has championed research, infrastructure, education?
Wait,
I mean, where's that coming from?
The private sector?
Okay.
I'm not talking about doing all that stuff.
I'm talking about this.
Let's not be stupid. Let's not be dysfunctional. You can have good government. I'm all for that. But let's not have dysfunctional government, which has been so unnerving.
Do you know anybody who's for dysfunctional government?
I mean, I know 435 people on Capitol Hill.
Who's running on that ticket? Okay, you had another question.
All right, I'm going to wrap this up by asking you about the Pope. The Catholic Church has chosen a new leader, Francis, of Argentina, a Jesuit, somebody who's known as a humble leader in the church. Mark?
Well, I was thrilled. I found his humility enormously appealing. I love the fact that he has spoken about income inequality, about the sin of the misappropriation of resources in a society where people are deprived, where there are people who are poor, that that's an offense against the common decency. And I just found him, it's a little bit like Jerry Ford succeeding Richard Nixon. And I don't mean anything to Pope Benedict, but I mean there was a sense of grandeur and almost whether the product red shoes or all the trappings of the Pope, and this man just comes into it and he lives in a simple apartment.
To the hotel,
take a taxi, takes a bus where people could come up and talk to him. I mean, to me, it's encouraging as a Catholic. My church is hurting from arrogance and from its indifference to the suffering of children that were abused and the inclination of the leadership to protect the institution rather than the children. And I'm encouraged.
I was thrilled for Mark. So when your institution is under threat, you feel you have a lot of hostility, you feel things are slipping away, you've got internal problems, there's a tendency to turn inward and to focus on yourselves. Mm-hmm. And one of the things he said, he hasn't really said that much in public, but one of the really nice things he said, he would prefer a church that goes out and has accidents in the street than to be self-referential and sick.
That's right.
And so that's exactly the right attitude. When your institution is under assault, you're feeling like the weight is on it and the history might be flowing away, like the Republican Party, don't turn inward, go outward. And his instinct, I think, is exactly right on that.
David is right.
David Brooks, Mark Shields, we thank you both.